The state has no business in the bedrooms of the nation. It was with that slogan that Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau fought to legalize abortion in the early 60s. Now, it's hard to disagree with that sentiment. Very few people want the government intruding in their private lives. But if you truly examine that slogan in the context of the abortion debate, we'll realize how empty it really is.
Even before Canada became a country, British North American law regulated abortion. Abortion could only be performed in the rarest of circumstances, for instance, when a woman's life was in danger. By 1869, the Canadian government passed a law that called for a life sentence for anyone who performed an abortion. But when the British changed their law in the early 1960s, some elite members of the Canadian society began to push for change here too. The Globe and Mail, the United Church of Canada, and the Canadian Medical Association began pushing for legalized abortion.
Interestingly then, the early feminist movement was not the main advocate for legal abortion.
But by 1969, the argument shifted from protecting doctors to protecting women's rights. Prime Minister Trudeau's government passed the Omnibus Bill, which considered abortion a private decision. Despite Trudeau's call for limiting government's role in the bedrooms of the nation, he had no qualms using the government to subsidize and support abortion through publicly funded health care. Now, specifically, the bill changed Section 251 of the Criminal Code, broadening the permissibility of abortion from just life of the mother to health of the mother. Under the law, other abortions were still illegal and doctors could be charged with life imprisonment, while patients could be charged with 2 years imprisonment. But the word health could mean anything. In fact, according to the Constitution of the World Health Organization at that time, health is a state of complete physical, mental, and societal well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity.
Therapeutic abortion committees were created all across the country, and women had to justify their abortions to these committees. Committees that were run by pro-lifers would deny most abortions. Committees run by abortion advocates would approve almost all of them. It was this general inequality that convinced abortion advocates to fight the law in courts.
In 1969, Morgenthaler began to specialize in performing abortions, boasting that he performed at least 5,000 abortions illegally, even inviting a TV crew to record one. Between 1974 to 1988, he was in and out of jail. But the last time he was imprisoned, the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms had been passed as part of our Constitution. He used it to challenge the legitimacy of abortion law, arguing that restricting access to abortion violated Section 7 of the Charter, which states, "Everyone has a right to life, liberty, and the security of person, and the right not to be deprived thereof, except in accordance with the principles of fundamental justice." Morgenthaler used the Charter to turn abortion from one of health to one of freedom for Canadian women. The Supreme Court agreed with Morgenthaler, and in 1988 struck down the abortion law.
But even though the highest court in the land agreed with him, they never said it was a fundamental right.
The judges agreed that the court cannot presume to resolve all of the competing claims advanced in a vigorous, healthy public debate. The judges called Parliament, which is supposed to reflect the will of the people, to act on the issue. Even Justice Bertha Wilson, the strongest advocate of abortion, argued for a developmental view of abortion law.
The precise point in the development of the fetus at which the state's interest in its protection becomes compelling should be left to the informed judgment of the legislature, which is in a position to receive submissions on the subject from all the relevant disciplines.
In other words, the Supreme Court said the law can intervene in the bedrooms of the nation when it at least involves the life of a child later in pregnancy. And this idea that Parliament has a right to limit abortion rights was echoed in subsequent abortion rights cases like Borowski, Degla, and Dodd.
This was why the progressive conservative government of Brian Mulroney tried to pass a bill that would legalize abortion in order to preserve the life or health of the mother. The term health was not clearly defined, meaning most abortions would still be legal.
But both pro-life and abortion advocates opposed it, saying it did not go far enough, and the bill was defeated by the narrowest of margins. Today, all the major political parties have refused to revisit the issue.
This means Canada is one of the few countries in the world with no abortion law. Abortion is legal throughout all 9 months of pregnancy for any reason or for no reason at all. And you and I as taxpayers pay for those abortions. Even the most liberal European countries limit abortion later in pregnancy. All this despite the fact the Supreme Court has never said abortion is an absolute right. And again, it's hard to say abortion is a private right if it's publicly funded. Simply put, thanks to Trudeau and Morgenthaler, Canada's bedrooms have more protection than Canada's children.